Hello, my friend. It's Pat Sloan here, and today is the last block in the Stronger Together sew along. We're doing the center part. So each of these sections, Cherise Spain designed to highlight something about inventor Garrett Morgan. And so the middle part is about the zigzag stitch portion of sewing machines. And he is the inventor of that. So she tells you a little bit more in here, and you can also follow her over on her Instagram and her YouTube channel, where she's also crocheting this on her YouTube channel, which is super cute. That's so cute. So I had already cut, this is the inner border. I already cut that too, but I have the sections cut, which is all, it's all you need to do that middle section of the zigzag. But I want to show you some other things that I did. The cutoffs from doing these units. These cutoffs, I made two things. I made a whole bunch of 3.5-inch half square triangles, which I am going to use in the border somehow, where the border is just solid on the corners. I don't know whether to make it symmetrical or asymmetrical. What I'll do, or I might do something a little bit different. So I'm going to play around with those units for that border. But also then you had a smaller cutoff when we did this part. And I sewed those together and made this little block. So sweet. I think it looks like champagne. Champagne. It's beautiful, beautiful colors. I don't know if I'll just put it in the block bag, or I could make it into a rug mug, or I could use it as the label. I could put like white just around the edge so I can write on that part and then use this as a label. So those are just some options. So I did want to give you a follow-up on another inventor before I sew the block. Do you remember when I talked about the Inventor Day the other day? It was, celebrating inventors, and about the rotary cutter. And I said I had gotten to see the prototype of the Olfa rotary cutter. And Olfa invented the rotary cutter. They were the inventors of it. So here is a picture of the prototype. It is the one that's, I think it's on the bottom, and it's a little, the plastic's kind of gruffed up, and it was fascinating to see it because it's a prototype. It's just something to see if it would work. And they have this in their offices in Japan, Olfa does, and they allowed it in 2014 to come to the U.S. for a 35th anniversary celebration that I was invited to. There was a small group of us that were invited to come and see this and sort of hear a talk and get to see a lot of the different products that they've kept in their archives. So I went today and searched to see what I have about my oldest Olfa rotary cutters. This is the original style. That's what's in the other, that's what it developed into. The prototype became this. It doesn't have any ergonomics, but it's super useful, and it's what everybody used for the longest time until they started building in some ergonomics. Now, over the years, they've done a few specialty ones, and of course, they've changed the ergonomics tremendously. So, and they've come out with some different colors, but here's where, it's an easy release. But these two are anniversary editions, and I just wanted to show them to you because the silver one is the 25th anniversary, and you can see that what they did was change the style. They, even though this is still flat and doesn't have a lot of ergonomics, they did make some curve. They did have some grippy stuff put on there so that, your fingers don't sort of slide around. It still has the screw on this version to release the blade. And then when they had the red one came out for the 40th anniversary, it's pretty much identical to the silver one. They did sort of shore up the body a bit. It doesn't have as big of a seam there on the side, but otherwise it's kind of pretty much the same. And I know that I talked to them about this, and they decided for their anniversary ones to make them as similar to the original as what they're still producing. So that's, was a nod to the original one for the anniversaries. The one that has the quick release is my favorite because that's so easy to change your blade. There's no excuse. You never get the screw on wrong. They're fabulous. Alrighty, I'm gonna sew up my zigzag block. This thread cutter is fabulous for when you're chain piecing like this and you have, all of these, threads in between because I was chain piecing. This is a old rotary cutter blade, and it's encased in between this flower. And then if
this side gets, you know, dull. You just can rotate this. So you get a new life out of your old blades. I don't put a new blade. I put an old blade in here. And so to do the thread in between, you just put it between. And there you go. Another one. I love this thing because it's also cute.
The pattern crosses two pages, so be sure that you're doing that. The first part is the top, which is these, so you're going to be doing half of them this way and then half of them the other direction for the bottom, so that when they sew together, they make this zigzag shape. If they were all the same, if they were all like this, when you rotate them, this is what you would get, so you're not going to get the zigzag. So be careful with that. Be sure that you're doing the two different directions so you get it right. And a little while later, you have a whole block. The zigzag one does take a little bit more work than those other ones, but it is so worth it. I love it. So it looks fabulous in the middle. I love the colors that Charisse picked out for the whole thing. Those were her color palette. I think it's gorgeous. This is the fabric for the border, which is also beautiful. I'm just going to put it up here as an audition, because what I want to do is play around next Tuesday with seeing how those extra half square triangles will work in that we have from the sew and flips. So these guys, I want to see how they might, you know, some different options they might do out here on the border. Like you could do things like have them sort of, because they'd be the same size, you know, the border will be the same size, but you know, play around with those, but not today. That'll be for next week after I sew the rest of this middle, the inner border, and then next Tuesday I'll look at all of these. There are also cutoffs from today. There are lots of cutoffs, and they will make tiny half square triangles, so I'm not sure. I will probably run them through the machine and then decide. I don't know about actually putting them in the quilt, because they would be kind of cool in the inner border, like do another inner border, because I think there's enough teal, because this is not that, they won't be that big, but you could do like the white and then these little guys. We'll see how crazy I get, or if I just do it like the pattern. No, I know I'm going to do these. So these ones for sure I'm going to do. options. Okay, I have a couple of things else today. I want to show you the kit words, that you know, these cutouts, the panels. So I want to talk about that a minute and put some of them up there and sort of show you what's going on. Then I did a little reorganizing of another group of things. So I thought I'd run that clip and then stay to the end, because I'm a huge fan of TED Talks. Just, they are so varied. And I learn so much, and they are just sort of an intro sometimes into a topic, because they're not very long, and so you can get your feet wet on it, whether you want to learn more. And there was one recently that I watched. Then I ended up going and watching a bunch of other stuff by the author, or the talk. You know, she's an author and she's a neuroscientist, and so I just thought I want to share that. So that's at the end. Okay, so the next thing I have to do here is take these down. So we can look at the kit. What I did, cut some of the kit out before the Super Bowl game, and then I didn't get the rest of it cut out. So these are two. These are all the ones that go in the four quadrants. And what I discovered is that the panel has some extra ones. So I'm just going to kind of put these up here. Now, if you buy the kit, you get the panel, but also if you buy the fat quarter bundle or the half yard bundle, it also comes with the panel. So the panel is sold out as is. See, there's, I love the rainbow. Here's one. But what happened was I got to the point where I needed to cut this guy, the sun. Because the place that he goes in the pattern is wonderful. Let me get it. I love how it is at the top here. But the thing is, those blocks are a little bit smaller. These here, well, this one is like the biggest of these other four in the center. It's like 8.5, and the other ones you cut at 8, which finishes at 7.5. And for the most things, that's great. But this beautiful, beautiful sun, which look at the mouth, look at the mouth. It's this. It's a planet. Isn't that cute? Well, I don't want to cut it down. If I put it in one of the other spots, I don't have to cut it as much. Or I could just not put it in, which would make me sad, but I could make it a pillow. So I got stuck. So then I was like, okay, well, we're going to watch the game. So I hate when that happens. You're rolling along, and then you're like, where are the other ones? You're like, oh, okay, this decision, I'm just not sure where to go with it. There are actually a few extras. So this one, which I really love the saying, be yourself. This one's not used in the pattern. And I definitely am going to change out the bird. I like the bird, but I like some of the other ones a lot better that are not used. So this one and the rose says buy flowers on the hand. I love that. Love that. Those two are not in the pattern. So I'm thinking of switching them out and then deciding on this sun, whether I would just go ahead. I really like it in the quilt, so I probably will do it. But do I make it into one of the quadrants so that it's not so, it can stay bigger and then just put one of the other things? But it does look so cool in that block, doesn't it? Doesn't it look cool, like arranged around that block? Decisions, decisions. So this one's not, it's not coming together like I hoped, you know, like I just thought like, okay, I just cut it out. But when I realized I had to cut that one down so much, I was like, oh, I don't want to. Well, let me just run this little clip of organizing because I had some bins to go through that I was like, I had no idea what was in them. So let's see what's in these bags. I know they were just parts of projects. They were things that we were doing for testing some stuff on the machines and who knows what. Oh, there's some instruction sheets. So we've got some sort of polyester threads, some bobbins, pre-wound bobbins, and then pieces, lots of pieces that were for doing samples. So all the fabric stuff. And I save the bags. I don't know about you, but I'm always saving bags. I think most of this is just fabric that can be moved on. They're just small pieces. They're not, I'm just trying to check, be sure I didn't leave a project in any of these. Nope, doesn't look like it. Here's quilting with embroidery. Oh, I know this is a special panel they did for us to do some practice work on. They had it printed like at Spoonflower. About Baby Lock did. They being Baby Lock. And then we could use it. See there, it has Baby Lock. So I will definitely keep this because it's so cool. But we were just doing some testing and that was an extra one. Here is another that we did some testing and they sent along some funky different things for us to play around with. So there's like some interfacings. We'll just keep that for a bit. Here's another one with just, yeah, we were sewing some stuff up to do practice pieces. So this is a lot of practice fabric and some interfacings that probably just get rid of that and let the fabrics move on. Let those go on. Okay, one more in this group. So it's like this has been probably in the drawer for like 2 years or more. Here, okay, this I have to do something with, right? Embroider that. Wake up and smell the coffee. there, look at this. Look. So that one, so what else is on there? Well, so it's just in one corner of like a four patch. And then there's some of the embroideries from my Solaris. That's my design that's in the Solaris. And here's another one. So these were just being stitched out. Here's one I put to do a label. Isn't that fun? And here's some samples. These are also my embroideries in the Solaris. So look at that. Based on hand embroideries I had done. Here's, I think, another design I tried out. Oh no, this may be part of mine. Just a section. You could put it on if you did the whole thing, you could put it out. Okay, so we'll take a look at those. And there's, you've seen that before. It is time to get your fabric together for the flapjacks, the fat eighth pattern that we're going to start on Friday and sew along. So some of the things to think about, and then I'm going to look at what my sort of background fabric would be. First of all, you need a yard and a 7/8, so basically 2 yards of this background fabric. But I think you can make it a little bit scrappy if you need to, as long as you can get your sort of border part out of it. Then the squares inside, if you had a couple of fabrics that worked to make up the 2 yards, I think that would be perfect. It doesn't have to all be exactly the same. So you can see these white squares all through here, and those are the background fabric, and that's what you have to decide will work with your bundle. So today, that's what I'm going to focus on, is sort of looking at the colors here and what will work and what I picked. So on this one was one of the Fig Tree pattern, Fig Tree Company fabric lines, and she had like 2 shades of coral. She has a gray, a green, some taupe, and some pinky reds. So those are the colors which, when you have the bundle and you hold it up, I don't have that bundle anymore, but I have a similar one I'll show you in a second. That picking the cream to go with that really made all the colors shine. The cream, the border were sort of secondary players. They were not like a focus and popped out at you, which is another way that you could go. Now, when you look at a bundle, this happens to be a fat quarter bundle of the Love Notes. When you look at it, and I'm not going to open it because I want you to see the colors, because that's really where this comes into play. If the colors are real cohesive like this, you've got a light blue, sort of a gray, the green, the coral, in sort of shades of coral, some taupe in here, and then a lot of these whites. So for this one, you could go something like this blue. You know, and that would be an accent, a wonderful accent. You could pick one of the corals out of here and use it as the accent. There's one that's sort of very tonal. You could try just going with one of the, with a more tonal taupe like that, and it would give a very much a feel like this, or of course white. You know, you could go with that one. So if you're using a fat eighth bundle that has sort of a more of a range of colors, then either maybe pick a very neutral, like a cream, off-white, even black or navy, or just go more fun and find something in the color range. Now, the one I'm working with is sort of a mishmash, because I started with Through the Woods. Let me get the little tag here. So this is Through the Woods fabric line, and I used some of it. I used it for the Happy Everything. So I had to add to it. So I have a good portions. The fat eighth looks like this. It is half of a fat quarter, so it's a little bit smaller piece, and the pattern, you know, has you, you know, cutting. We'll tell you what to cut, but this is the size of the piece. The fat quarter is a little bit bigger. I did add in then this grouping here is pretty much the bundle, and then here are pieces I added, and some of them will probably be used a bit more because, you know, I used up several of these pieces cutting things, and then some of those have pieces out of it, so they can't be used in as many places. But the whole color palette here is the gray, the gold, a lighter gray, and a cream. So it is really a tight palette. It is not like this one, which has a lot of different colors, you know, even though they're very cohesive, and same with this one, has maybe 5 colors that are a range. So I started pulling out some fabrics, and I thought, oh, what can I use? So I looked at what I had, that there was a little bit more of it, and, you know, being that there is some, like here, like, see, I used some of this one, and I want to use these lights too, but all the lights actually have pattern on them, so they are not going to be difficult to use because they do have pattern. So I could go with one of these solids. So this first solid is more creamy, which is a contrast, so that like these whites will not blend in and disappear to it, because it'll have some contrast. Then I found one here that I have enough of that's a little bit more ivory. So it's a little less of that creamy and a little more ivory and actually closer to this background. And I still think these have enough pattern that they're not going to get lost. And like I'm adding in this gray and that definitely won't get lost. So I thought, well, what do I have that might be fun in those circles in the border? And so I have some polka dot. And this polka dot is vibrant and it has lots of personality. So remember, it's going to be like a square. So like I can mock it up here so that you could see, you know, if I were to, there would be like a square there and then maybe, you know, a square over here, that kind of a thing. So there would just be pops of these squares, but then it would be all around the outside as well. So that's actually kind of fun. You know, I don't have to decide quite yet because I can cut these things and then audition squares. So there's the polka dot. Then I thought, well, what about my harmony? I have this cream harmony, which would be really pretty. So you can see like a mock-up there. You know, if that's the square, so that background square would be pretty, and then this would be the border of it. Or I could also go dark. And so dark would look different than what's up on the wall. And that's kind of exciting. It gives it a whole different vibe to have those dark spots. I mean, you can even see here, even with the gray, because that's about, you know, the grays are not real dark. There's a butterfly with a moss with the gray. So the black is really cool, and then it would border in black. I mean, it wouldn't have to border in the same thing, but I do think it keeps it cohesive to do that. So I have to think about it. I really am not sure which one I want to use, but I do know it will be one of these. Probably not the solid. I don't see any reason to use the solid. I want to do something a bit more playful. The solid was, and that isn't solid on there. That's a little tiny print. There's a small print on here, which was from the fabric line. So I don't know. The black might be kind of fun. The polka dot would be very fun. I think the polka dot would be a little, I mean, visually, I think it might get a little lost, but I'm not sure. So I can do a mock-up and I don't have to cut it until I've cut out some of the squares. So that's probably the route I will go. So the thing that I wanted to tell you about here at the end was that I do watch a lot of TED Talks, and I watched one by Lisa Genova. And it starts out talking about, she starts out by saying, you know, have you ever misplaced your keys? Did you ever try to remember a name and it didn't come up? You know, all of these kind of memory things. And why does that happen? And is it something to worry about or not to worry about? And I loved what the message that she gave and how to tell when you should worry. And when it is just normal, and why it's normal. That was what I thought was so interesting. Why is it normal that we just don't remember all these different things? And it's good, it's normal. So she has several talks out there. If you just go into YouTube and put her name, but I'm going to put the one down below that sort of kicked me off going off and reading about her stuff. She also has a book, so I'm going to link that down below. So if you wanted to do sort of deep dive into memory and how it works, she's a neuroscientist, and that's her thing. So it was really great. All right, my friend, it's time for you to make your stronger together block, and get your fat eighths out, or fabrics you want to cut up to make a fat eighth bundle so that you can sew along and make this super cute flapjacks quilt. So I love you. Mwah. Thank you for being here in the Sloan Zone. I will see you online.